Hello, I'm your host, Latrell Siemens. Welcome to my very first inaugural episode of my new Binko TV broadcast show, The Justice of Our Lord. I'm going to try to bring you weekly messages, help, and the Word. Let us begin. Philosophers have told us, know yourself. How can this be possible without first knowing where you yourself came from? Yes, we know about the birds and bees, but no. The birds being your mother's vagina, and the bees being your father's scrotum. Pre-sperm recordings are quite ordinary. The sperm sequence itself is noteworthy for a race of which the sperm is very conscious. His travails in reaching the ovum are many. In other words, a sperm's tendency to get more and more sperm will be a race of which it does not have to suffer as much as it might have to suffer. But do you know of man's history before your parents? Many do not. And that is why today, congregation, I will be starting at the very beginning of the start of man. When God, He Himself, first did boot up the computer of which we are living. Boy, I am glad He did. And I'll be reading from the Holy Scriptures in the Binko translation about the origins of man. This is a cold-blooded and factual account of your last 60 trillion years. It is not just an honest, open-ended narrative about what happened in the past, but an unbridled attempt to explain something. The test of any knowledge is its usefulness. Does it make one happier or one able? By it and with it, can we better achieve our goals? This is useful knowledge. It is the true hope for people on the positive and positive path. It is real and is important that you know where man came from, just like where my wife came, right? If there's nobody here, no, I can stop you from being nice, and not just me. Follow along with me. Alright, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the whole earth, so that the earth of all things, which at first is the same as it is in the beginning, the whole planet, the planet, the whole. The Lord said to me, we are all equal beings. That is a matter of creation. The universe, the universe, the universe, and all creation, all of which are created. Then there were a number of things that I had to explain. Isn't that wonderful news, congregation? God creates the whole planet, all at once, the beginning there. Life on the evolutionary timeline is very grim, very tooth and claw. You don't need help if a life has changed too much. And all right that a lifetime could lead to will, but of course, but God Himself did make it, the universe to be equal with all other universes and around it. Did God make those universes around it? I don't know. In those days, God said, we should be a little bit careful as we go to the moon because we can't see. So we should be like, okay, see a little bit of light coming down, that's fine. God was the light, and that light existed. Therefore, God did exist too. The earth was without form, and darkness was upon the face of the sun. The first day was the same as the second, and the second as the third. And the third night was the same as the fourth, until the fifth day was the first day. Now, brothers and sisters, who among us has never felt this way? Every day feels the same sometimes, but it is important to know that God made it that way. He did not have to do that. He could have made the universe so that when you wake up in the morning, a new color had arrived or a new body part was shown. Why did God create such a sameness all throughout His creation? Let us keep reading. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters. Let it divide the waters from the waters. God made two firmaments, and greater firmament also, and also the smaller firmament. And God called the angels and made the angels, and they came and said, you shall be with me. But he came and said, why are you afraid of this man, that he will not be your God? He did not speak to him until he became his God. The plots of the weeper are many and pathetic. But what is the nature of the world in the present? And what is the nature of the world in the future?
We'll return after these messages.
Different kind of world. Advertisements, these are the thoughts of an individual or group, a man, and what is his reason? I ask that we call him the man of this day. He knows nothing. Human character development is cut short by aging and death. Imagine what might have become the genetic engineering of the first generation of doctors working in the 1950s to control obesity. A more radical kind of upgrade might be possible if we suppose a more computational view of the mind that would make its way to the mind through using a neural network. In chapter 1, verse 8, and the God said, let the earth bring forth grass, let the earth bring forth the 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 grass. Let the earth bring forth the grass. And God saw many creatures of the water he had made and gave them their names. Fishes and the smaller fishes and the creatures that move along the water. And God called the sea a fish house. And God saw that it was a very good house for them. Poaceae, or Gramineae, is a large and nearly ubiquitous family of monocycladonous flowering plants known as the grasses. It includes the cereal grasses, bamboos, and the grasses of natural grassland and species cultivated in lawns and pasture. The latter are commonly referred to collectively as grass. Water is inorganic, transparent, tasteless, odorless, and nearly colorless chemical substance, which is the main constituent of Earth's hydrosphere, atmosphere, and all the fluids living in all of the living organisms. It is vital for all forms of life. Even though it provides no calories or organic nutrients to human beings, as it contains no animal products. Much of the universe's water is produced as a byproduct of star formation that is also present in the atmosphere. It is present in the atmosphere itself and is used by the solar system to create water. Many of our biological shortcomings, such as aging, disease, feeble memories and intellects, and a limited emotional repertoire and inadequate capacity for sustained well-being, are difficult to overcome. And to do so will require advanced tools and training. This can also be accomplished with advanced mental training. Others maintain that the living, eternal recurrence of the same is a necessary step if the Ubermensch is to create new values untainted by the existing circumstances or problems that arise. Going back to verse 10, God said, let the earth bring forth the earth, yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit after his kind. And it was so. And God made the beast of the earth after his kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything after its kind forms, walking in all things that creep on this earth after his kind. God saw that the creeping was good. After these things, God blessed the earth and the creatures of the earth, and created man to be saved from the wrath of God. If we collectively extend a certain threshold of traditionally understood moral merit, God will reward us in all ways with infinitely long lives in heaven. But if we fail to do so, he will soon bring forth an apocalypse and end the world. Water probably exists in the abundance of other galaxies too, because its components, hydrogen and oxygen, are among the most abundant elements in the universe. And it is in some other galaxy, such as Neptune, that a big reason appears for it to exist. That example, the largest and the most abundant galaxy in our galaxy is the ELA 945. Now, I've been there and I've read a lot online, and we will not be saved from an apocalypse by going there. No, sir. Okay, verse 14. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply. Fornicate wildly with like creatures and fill the waters and the seas with seed." There's some evidence that the human race is very similar to those who have been persecuted in the United States in the past. One entering on the sperm side and one entering on the ovum side. If the matter were still important, some time could be spent determining things like this. For the Lord answers dually in present time. The Lord has to deal with various elements of the universe so that he can find an alternate way through time. For example, to deal with the presence of a strange, mysterious entity who might be the origins of the original world. The earth, which is denser than water, emerged from the water, and that water was filled with the seed of all things living in the past and in the future. Alright, back to verse 15. And all the fruit of the trees, let them have the fruit, for the earth is the Lord's. And the cattle will also have the fruit, the Lord said. Fruit after their kind to the fowls, to the beasts. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have domination over the creeping things. When Sally's bulimia and weight became a concern, her mother institutionalizes her against her will. Tim, a not herbs, who has a peculiar sexual appetite, finds Sally at her weakest and cleverly begins using treats to manipulate her into taking erotic photos of herself with fruits and vegetables. With a new outlook on both love and life, Sally makes a move to seduce Tim before her release, and her pan goes awry when a graphic photo of a naughty note falls into the wrong hands. Just what will Sally do to protect her reputation and save Tim from losing his job? All right, verse 18. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, over all of the earth, and over everything in the earth. God blessed them, and God said to them, God bless you. Despite his size that spanned a few galaxies, the Lord had a tiny computer, and that computer could do anything that he wanted. With that computer, he made our universe, and he made your mother, your father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That little computer made every feeling, every thought, and every person you've ever met in your entire life. And I couldn't be happier that we have such a graceful Lord to bless us with this simulation. Let's close in for a prayer. God, thank you for today, and thank you for tomorrow, and thank you for the future, and thank you for the past. Let our family members be healed from all the diseases you let into this computer, and all the illnesses that you let into our hearts. And please free our friend and companion, Ben Johannes, from the state penitentiary of Alabama and Mississippi. And please do not extradite Bink to Frankfurt this April. Thank you, congregation, for our first episode of the show, and I wish you all a good Sunday.
We live in the extraordinary age of computers. Between the web, changing computer platforms, innovative hardware, and incredible new software, we're in a rapid state of change.
Years ago, Alvin Toffler wrote a book called Future Shock, in which he predicted these very changes. He warned that a day would come when people would have to spend a lot of time learning new technologies.
I think the day is here because he was right. To survive in today's world, young people can no longer be content with being merely computer literate. They now have to be computer competent. This may be easier said than done. Most young people today know more about computers than we do.
That's right, Tony. It doesn't just happen that way. We really have to figure out how.
Let's face it. Students love computers.
And Tony, so do I. With the availability of vivid graphics, simulations, online support, and individualized instruction using a variety of learning styles, computer technology can increase desire to want to learn.
There's no need to persuade any of you about the value of computers. The issue for most of us is, how do we integrate them into the curriculum?
Hello, I'm Edward Asner. As a professional, I've had my chances to put a smile on your face and a chuckle in your heart. Sometimes I succeeded. That's important to me. But what's also important to me is the everyday enjoyment of life, your life. The people you've just heard are suffering. How can they be helped? A friend may be all that's needed to brush away a simple case of the blues. But when your mood darkens to persistent feelings of helplessness, hopelessness, and fatigue, where enjoyable tasks become burdens, and the world takes on a frightening air, you need more than just a friend.
How often have you said to yourself,
there's all this pressure to use computers more, but what can I do?
Despite the ongoing nature of these symptoms, many individuals still tend to attribute the problems to personal weakness. This was the case with Ruth Dobson, who was overcome with sadness when she developed depression.
First, I was just sad. And then this condition became worse. I was sadder and sadder to the point that I didn't want to be with my friends. I couldn't keep from crying. And it was such a hopeless feeling. I thought surely that I was losing my mind.
You feel at times severe and unbearable feelings. Feelings that, despite your best intentions, just won't go away.
There's all this pressure.
Depression can engulf you in a variety of ways. You feel down, sad, hopeless, your energy sapped away. No matter what the issue, life seems void of joy or pleasure. Food, sex, even simple conversation seems empty. Pessimism overtakes you, and nothing really seems to matter.
80 to 90% of those of us who suffer from depression are treatable and return once again to real happiness and a productive life. Together, let's learn the facts and begin the process of mending our minds.
I didn't want to be with my friends. I was losing my mind.
You need more than just a friend.
You need a computer.
Why stop at one? Why not two? Two computers would be great because one could be an IBM compatible and the other could be Mac-based.
Good idea. Whenever you need to do word processing or spreadsheets, they could use the IBM compatible.
And to use Photoshop, Quark, and other design programs, could use the Mac.
Absolutely, but let's not stop there.
Today, we're going to take part in a really exciting opportunity. We'll be in communications with scientists from NASA in Houston.
How are we going to do that?
We'll use this computer.
Wow.
Time saver tip.
Here's a tip. Figure out who your computer wizards are and then ask them to meet with you. Recognize their talent by calling them your special computer consulting committee.
Time saver tip.
Now that you're online, you might want to access an online digital recording site and create a sample of your own music.
Can I really? Wow, how did you find out about this?
Through a computer course I'm taking. It's the only way I can keep up with your generation.
You're really cool, Mrs. Smith.
Oh, thanks.
So I think computers have opened a new avenue because visually, they're much more oriented to a visual world. They grow up in a world of video and TV. And to some extent, it's to our advantage to take what they already know and use it to help them be more successful.
You don't have to be driven to the point of desperation or suicide to recognize that life's worth living. You need help.